uniformly mixed, you would add the dry ingredients and then freeze them in a mold of some kind, such as an empty tin can or an ice cube tray. Suet will become rancid in temperatures above 50 degrees. Bird baths can be acquired fairly inexpensively, or you can even make one for free if you happen to have some of these materials on hand. And it's not too expensive to buy one of these heating elements for bird baths to keep the water in liquid for birds in the winter. And if you're if you'd like to make a bird box, I recommend you check out allbirds.com. Different birds need different kinds of boxes. They have different dimensions. Each one of these pictured species here, plus some others that you don't see on the slide, are represented in the allbirds.com list, where they'll give you the correct box floor dimensions, the box height dimensions, the entrance height, the entrance diameter, and how far above the ground you should place that box. And so here's a basic bird box, a blue bird box in this case. Notice the three holes at the top of each side of the box, that's for ventilation. Notice the holes on the bottom for drainage, and notice the hinges on the side of that bird box, which allow you to open it and inspect or clean it. Also, a metal pole is a good idea for mounting. It tends to make it difficult for predators to access that bird box. It might be a good idea to have the bird box in the shade so it doesn't overheat. A clear flight path to that bird box for the birds, and facing away from the prevailing wind. Starlings and house sparrows are not native. They were introduced to the United States and they have displaced our native birds. In fact, they sometimes kill the eggs and chicks. So they are not protected birds, and you are free to harass or trap them and do as you choose with these two species. Please don't put out colorful bird boxes because they attract predators. Please also don't put out bird boxes that have perches, as they are totally unnecessary for birds. Birds can fly right to the hole. They don't need a perch, and predators might be able to use that perch to access the eggs or the chicks. Also, you shouldn't use any material other than wood for your birdhouse, and you should not dangle a birdhouse from a branch. Squirrels with their sharp and powerful teeth can easily widen the hole so that they can gain entrance to the bird box and use it themselves. So you need to prevent them from being able to do that. And here are some ways to protect birdhouses from predators, especially if you choose to put one on the side of a tree, which would, so many animals can climb a tree and access that birdhouse, unless you have devices such as these ones that are pictured to prevent them from getting access. Clean the birdhouse at the end of the summer with a 9-to-1 solution of water and bleach. Scrub it clean, and think about putting out a winter roosting box, either homemade or purchased, because birds can gather together, keep each other warm, and stay out of the elements. See, here are some bird nesting materials, and it could be fun to offer them either in a suet feeder or just in a mesh bag, and watch to see if birds help themselves to some of this material. Caterpillars are an ideal baby food for chicks, and this mama black-capped chickadee is going to need to come up with 6,000 to 9,000 caterpillars to fledge her chicks. That's a lot of caterpillars. And Doug Tallamy is a well-known author and scientist who has explained and demonstrated conclusively that the caterpillars need native plants because they just can't eat the leaves of non-natives that have been introduced from other countries. They haven't had enough time over the thousands of years that evolution gives them a chance to kind of figure out how to eat the leaves of those plants that have chemical defenses that they haven't figured out how to overcome. And they just can't digest those leaves. So it's very important to currently, our landscapes have about 70% non-native plants and 30% native, and we should at least minimally switch those figures so that we have 70% native and 30% non-native, or better yet, aim for 100% native. And also, Doug Tallamy is pointing out that it's important for us to realize that we won't be able to give the wildlife a chance to recover simply by resorting to publicly owned land. So much of the land is now in private hands that that's where we need to be focusing our efforts and making sure that private land becomes a wildlife refuge. So the best trees, vines, and shrubs to plant for birds is offered by allaboutbirds.org, which is a website of the Cornell Laboratory of Ornithology. And an oak is a number one because there are so many caterpillars that are able to eat and do eat the leaves of an oak tree, and birds will come and help themselves to that feast. Mulberry fruits are delicious both for humans and birds. It's a messy tree, don't plant it above your sidewalk or your driveway. You'll track in that fruit, but otherwise in a different part of, in a suitable part of your property, just plant it and sit back and just delight in the sheer numbers as well as the diversity of birds that will come and feast on the mulberry tree. And here's another beautiful tree in all seasons, the sassafras, the native tree with fruits that are tempting to birds. The elderberry, I call this a edi medi ento ornithomental. You know, we talk about ornamentals as being beautiful plants, but there's no reason why wild native plants can't be just as beautiful as ornamentals. And so the edi medi refers to edible and medicinal, and the ento ornitho refers to entomology and insects, and ornitho, ornithology, birds. So it has edible value, medicinal value, because elderberry syrup is very effective in warding off the flu. Entomological value, because those insects will pollinate the flowers and get pollen and nectar there. And then the birds are enjoying the fruit as well. Wild raisin, or any of the viburnums for that matter, are edible for birds and good tasting for humans too in some cases, and just beautiful every season. So definitely an ornithomental and ento-ornithomental because they're pollinated. Maple leaf viburnum is found in the shade. It's just very small viburnum. On by contrast, the black haw viburnum is a small tree. And any of the dogwoods give edible fruit for birds. A gray dogwood might be stripped of its fruit in August or September by migrating birds helping themselves to that fruit. Red osier dogwood, what a fantastic ornithomental this is. Look at those red stems in the winter. White dogwood, another dogwood that offers edible food for birds. And you can get 10 of these by going to arborday.org. In fact, your choices are, besides white dogwood, you could choose American redbud or river birch or any of these half dozen conifers, or you could select one each of these trees in the middle. And all you have to do is give them a donation of any amount that you choose, and those trees are yours, arborday.org. Spice bush, those fruits are 50% fat, which is a good source of energy for birds. Birds love blueberries for sure, and they love juneberries, so do I. I understand why. Beautiful tree. Most people are unaware of juneberry. It flowers in May, and then the birds usually can access those fruits easier than humans can. But I can tell you those fruits are delicious and just as good, I think, as blueberries. And it's just a beautiful small tree in your landscape. Hawthorn, another edi medi ento ornithomental, has uses for humans as well as birds. Crabapple, beautiful in the spring. Black cherry and chokecherry, birds love them. Chokeberry, which is different from a chokecherry. This is not a cherry at all. It's actually a shrub that has been used ornamentally for a long time. And when people plant it, they're unaware that, yes, this is also edible for people as well as birds. You can make a variety of baked goods, for example, with this fruit. Now, if you'd want to find out if you can grow a black chokeberry where you are, and if you want to learn different facts about it, simply type either the common or Latin name along with Missouri, and you'll find the Missouri Botanical Garden fact page about that plant, and they have information about so many different plants. It's a great resource. So it'll tell you how high to expect that plant to get, and the girth, how wide it will be, when it blooms, the description of the bloom, what conditions it needs in terms of sun and water, and the uses of it, and and the fact that it attracts birds is shown right there, that it'll tolerate wet soil. And then you hit to the bottom, garden locations. And if you click there, you can find where to acquire that plant, what nurseries offer it. Birds eat blackberries and black raspberries and the fruits of staghorn sumac, even into the winter, that's available for birds. And even now, the winterberry holly fruits are there's a woods near where I live that still has a few of them left on this small tree. It's a dioecious tree, which means you need to have a male tree with male flowers near the female in order for the female to produce those flowers and fruit and to set fruit. Northern bayberry, late into the winter, this is providing fruit for birds. Probably not their first choice, but it's definitely a survival food. Conifers have seeds that are edible for birds. Also, they provide shelter, places to nest, and a number of different caterpillars. White pine provides food for, is a host plant for 200 different species of moths and butterflies. Eastern red cedar also has edible fruit for birds. And now, once you've decided what you want to plant, you'll have to, you'll want to pay attention to the details of microhabitats on your landscape. And because there might be more or less sun in different places, or the moisture and drainage might be different. Soil texture could be pretty uniform across your landscape, but you want to know if you have sandy or clayey soil, or if you have that desired optimal happy medium, which is called, I'm blanking now, oops. Loam is the name of that, you know, in desirable, percentages. Compaction, however, is not a condition that any plant can handle. If its soil is compacted, roots simply cannot grow, and that's true for any plant. So you'll want to do a test for compaction if there's any question in your mind. One easy way to do that is to plant a foot long, straightened wire hanger into the ground, and if you wiggle it around to a length of about a foot, and if it does not bend, then you're okay. But if it bends, then you have compacted soil. Soil micronutrients, soil fertility, nitrogen in particular, and the pH and salinity all could be tested by a soil laboratory, and the University of Connecticut will do that for you. So once you've decided what you want to plant, I advise that you dig a hole that's about twice as wide, or maybe even three times as wide, as you might think necessary. The reason for that is the roots are growing outwards and not down so much as out, because that's where the nutrients are, close to the surface, the nutrients and water both. So by digging a wider hole, you're making it easier for the roots to proceed outward. And for the same reason, try to resist the temptation to add compost or other fertilizer to that hole, because what you want the plant to do is send its roots beyond the hole that you've dug. And if you add the compost in there, you'll just be tempting the roots to hang out in the hole and not move outward as fast as they otherwise would. And if you keep the topsoil and subsoil in separate piles, then you can return them first the subsoil, then the topsoil when you put the plant in. And surrounding the plant with mulch is a good idea, the sapling, not against the trunk, but otherwise even out to the drip line is good. And you can create a lip or a basin of sorts, so that when it rains or when you irrigate the plant, it'll hold that water. And don't forget that plant might need your attention, at least especially the first couple of years. If there are periods of dry, there are dry spells, those plants need water, and just be aware of that. Protect your saplings in some way if you want to be assured that they won't, and if you know that their environments around hungry in the winter, you know, they can easily kill a perennial a sapling. So the photo at the bottom of the slide, it might be the easiest and cheapest, that spiral band of material there. Virginia creeper fruits are edible for birds, but not for humans. This is a vine that's fairly common. Here's another, two other vines are the wild grapes that we have, riverbank grape and fox grape. Many birds eat those fruits. Wild or limber honeysuckle is another one. and a ground cover, bearberry, sunlight, full sun conditions that are required. But if you have that condition, well, what a fantastic plant this is. It'll give you, it's an evergreen, and the fruits are not just for bears, they're for birds too. And what bird wouldn't appreciate some sunflowers out there? If the chipmunks and squirrels don't get them, they're available for the birds. But that's not the only plant that has edible seeds for birds. Black-eyed Susan, which is related to sunflowers, you can see. These are in the aster family. Purple coneflower is another one. And more plants for birds that have edible seeds are listed here. And sedum is the only one on this slide that is not a member of the aster family, the Asteraceae. So that's a good rule of thumb that plant family has a lot of plants that are beneficial for birds in that way. So here's some of those plants: purple coneflower, black-eyed Susan, coreopsis, sunflower, gay feather, even some grasses, switchgrass, and little blue stem. So if you leave the seed stalk standing through the winter, those seed resources are available for birds. Also, if you leave the leaves wherever you can, instead of raking them all up and disposing of them, for example, you could rake the leaves under shrubs, or perhaps leave them under trees as being part of the mulch for that tree. Many insects can overwinter there, and birds can find food in that leaf litter. And if you can leave dead trees and snags standing, that can provide places for birds to nest or give them access to the insects that will live there. Brush piles are good for sanctuary, shelter, and snacks. Birds can escape from predators there. They can ride out a storm inside a brush pile, or they can even find something to eat because there's so much wildlife going on in there. So gardening for wildlife connects us to nature. But where's the habitat here? So much of our default landscaping is for appearance and to make an impression, and does not have too much regard for nature. The lawn in particular, as a status symbol, has its origins with the aristocracy in Britain several centuries ago, and it was carried over to our country. It's a way to kind of demonstrate to everyone else, look how rich we are. We don't need to use all our land for growing crops. In fact, they would hire gardeners to use hand scythes to cut the grass for them. So here we go. These lawns are food deserts, they're polluters, they're resource guzzlers. We use far more synthetic pesticides on our lawns than farmers do, unconscionable amount of water as well. Our traditional lawn grass is Kentucky bluegrass, but this is really not a non-native grass. It's not from Kentucky, and it's actually from Europe, and it's fine in Britain where they've got wet summers, but we don't typically have wet summers. So this is a lawn on life support, and rather than supporting life. So fescues are worthy of considering. If you can transition to this turf type tall fescue, which looks remarkably like Kentucky bluegrass, by seeding it in. And this grass species can root down to about 4 feet. So it needs a lot less or no watering, and less fertilizer, less mowing is necessary. It can grow in shade or sun. So what if you have an area that you've been frustrated, how do I get the grass to grow here, either because there's shade or standing water or erosion? Well, the answer is simple: plant native perennial shrubs and trees that know exactly what to do in that spot. I invite you to visit Marianne Borges' thenaturalweb.org to just sample the variety of nature topics that she discusses and her fantastic photography. Environmental organizations are asking us to reduce lawns by 25% at least. I think that's a reasonable goal. And I think it's a goal that not only can we feel good about doing something for wildlife, but we're doing something for ourselves. We're giving ourselves a kind of a sanctuary for the soul, and some excitement of just watching what's going on and all the nature that we're attracting. So the folks on the left-hand side of the street have seen the light, but the ones on the right have some concerns, and we need to address them. How about vermin? Will natural landscapes attract them? The answer is no. Rats are not sustained by this kind of a landscape approach. Lyme disease ticks are a legitimate concern, but by creating paths for walking that will prevent ticks from making contact with us, they can't fly up to us after all, that will be a deterrent. And you can visit LymeDisease.org to learn more about preventing ticks in your yard. And you can perhaps choose to apply tick repellents with any of these four ingredients. You could also choose to spray your clothing and gear with permethrin at least 48 hours before use. It actually kills these insects, including ticks. It's non-toxic to us, lasts through 6 washings, and you can even buy factory-treated clothing that lasts through 70 washings. And think about all the tick predators out there that we can help, in particular, the frogs and toads are experts at finding every tick that they can. So a water feature might help there, and making sure that the water is not acid from the acid rain, perhaps by adding some limestone, will give them a chance to get to the levels of population where they can be effective. Natural landscapes are breeding grounds for mosquitoes. Is that true? No. Because in fact, lawns are more likely to have long-standing puddles than when you're planting perennials that will absorb that water. If you have a pond, which is a great idea for wildlife, stagnant water can be an issue. But if you install a solar-activated pump, that could be a solution. If you populate the pond with koi or goldfish or mosquito fish, they will prey on those mosquito larvae. You can also add the bacterium BTI, Bacillus thuringiensis israelensis. They're called mosquito dunks or mosquito bits, and that will solve the problem very effectively. Allergenic pollen also can be a concern, but the fact is that it's non-native plants and grasses that are producing that wind-borne allergenic pollen, not goldenrod, by the way, which is also often blamed for being allergenic. It is not. Pollinators visit and pick up pollen from those flowers, but there is no appreciable amount of pollen that is windborne from a goldenrod. It's the ragweed that's a culprit number one, a public enemy number one. Also lamb's quarters, red root amaranth, English plantain, and some grasses that are non-native as well can be problematic. And another legitimate concern would be your property value. But the fact is, a study has been done that if simply by planting one tree, and if it's just a beautiful tree and well-placed and has reached an impressive stature, that tree can add thousands of dollars to your property value. And that's just one plant. So if you're treating your entire property with this kind of aesthetic, that it's not only valuable to wildlife, but also beautiful, how can it help but improve your property value? And one thing to give a kind of an impression of beauty is to have massing of one particular species. It makes quite a statement. Or just have plenty of flowers wherever you are planting them in garden beds that are blooming at different times. Covering your foundation with plantings is helpful to give a good appearance. And I'll also notice there's a large pot in this picture. There's a bird bath. There are different things and paths. So that, and a large rock. So there are different ways to make it clear that this is a planned and not a random landscape. Here's other examples of having a landscape more defined, and crisp edges and bold patterns can help. Your first order of business might be to inventory invasive plants on your property. So you'll want to be able to identify and recognize them, and then you'll find them and make a realistic plan for eliminating or controlling them and follow through with that plan. Japanese knotweed is a terribly invasive plant that is very difficult to get rid of because the roots are pretty deep and substantial in size. And even if a small amount of root remains in the ground, that root fragment will be able to create more of these. Some people think that they're a bamboo, but it's not a bamboo. It's in the knotweed family. And those shoots that you see in the lower left here come up every spring. They are edible, by the way. They taste a lot like rhubarb, but you may have many more than you can eat. And at any rate, cutting it back to the ground every 3 weeks or so, and doing that for 3 or 4 years throughout the growing season will eventually cause those roots just to give up. Another approach could be to cover an area with a heavy plastic. And if any shoots do try to come up, you can simply stomp down on them and it's easy to kill them that way. Oriental bittersweet is a terrible nuisance because this vine can actually kill a tree by girdling it. And so if you find any oriental bittersweet vines that have made it to the canopy, please cut them at the base so that they won't be able to flower and set seed. And any of them that you find on your property, you're likewise going to want to just dig up if you can possibly can. Autumn olive is a shrub that has made itself far too welcome. It's invasive and displaces our native shrubs. The same is true of multiflora rose. And burning bush has been sold for the fact that it makes a splash for a couple of weeks in the fall, but it's no longer available in the nursery trade because it's recognized that this is an invasive shrub. Goutweed, garlic mustard, black swallowwort, other plants to be on the lookout for. And there are a number of others as well. Migrating birds prefer native fruits. A study was done in Plymouth, Massachusetts, which demonstrated that the birds were eating blueberries, black cherries, black raspberries, even when it was difficult for them to find them, and when there were a lot more Japanese barberry, oriental bittersweet, or multiflora rose fruits available, but birds turned up their beaks at those fruits because they just weren't as good tasting and nutritious. Poison ivy is a native plant, and those fruits are edible and are available in the winter for birds to eat, but you have every reason to eliminate poison ivy on your property where people might come in contact with it. And here are some approaches to transitioning either from a poison ivy infested area or a lawn that you want to convert to a garden bed or weeds or whatever you're finding yourself, wherever you want to start over. Sheet mulching is the way to do it. You don't have to dig at all. You simply smother that vegetation with either cardboard or six thicknesses of newspaper, six sheets of newspaper, overlapping, moisten them, and then add mulch. You can also buy something called ramboard, which comes in a roll. It's like cardboard in a roll, and they'll ship that to you if you have a large area to transition. Mulch suppresses weeds and it keeps the soil moist and cool and it enriches the soil. And you can use any number of different types of mulch depending on the purpose. Annual beds for either flowers or traditional vegetables that are annuals, grass clippings, straw, shredded leaves, and pine needles or pine straw are all acceptable methods of mulching. It's a myth, by the way, that pine needles make the soil acidic. It's simply not true, even though that supposed fact is published in many even books and authors still are under the impression that that's the case, but it's not. Shredded leaves and pine straw also work for perennial beds, although leaves will decompose fairly quickly. So pine bark is also an option. Sawdust, wood chips is very, very commonly a choice and a good choice for perennial beds, or chipped branch wood when branches are chipped mechanically. Mulch smart, avoid dyed mulch, please. It is often contaminated with creosote and CCA, bad for the plants. Don't overuse it. This volcano approach to volcano mulching a tree invites that tree to send out roots into the mulch, and then as the mulch decomposes, those roots are exposed. And think about mulch as a temporary expediency. Ultimately, you want a lot of plants, and you don't want to have a sea of mulch with plants here and there. So if the plants fill in the planting space, well, then you don't need to be concerned with, there'll be hardly any weeds there. This happens to be a rain garden. So the water has been directed into this area from the drain spouts, and the plants can make use of that water. And if there's any excess, it comes, down that, at the bottom of the slide here into that pathway, the pebble pathway. And so a lot of that water and much more water is absorbed by perennials than by the lawn. Ground covers are a living mulch because they also prevent weeds and retain moisture and keep the soil cool. And additionally, they can hold soil in place on slopes if that's an issue. I mentioned bearberry as one of my favorite ground covers. Thyme is great if you have, if you're a beekeeper, beekeepers often treat their bees with thyme oil because that helps them to contend with varroa mites, which are such a serious problem. Three-leaved cinquefoil, another beautiful ground cover. Golden star with those yellow flowers. Wild ginger in dense shade. It might take a while for it to establish, but it's able to handle dense shade. Bishop's hat is another dense shade-tolerant species, beautiful leaves. Allegheny pachysandra is an alternative to the Japanese pachysandra. It's a native ground cover, which I think is beautiful. Barren strawberry is a good option, and so is wild strawberry. In fact, wild strawberry is fantastic as a host plant for a number of different caterpillars. Hummingbirds are beneficials because they are both predators and pollinators. They eat a lot of insects because that's how they get their protein. And they the ruby-throated hummingbird is the only one you're likely to see here in New England. We don't need to be concerned about their population. They've actually doubled in size in the last several decades. If you'd like to invite them to your property, provide moving water, that tempts them. You can give them a place to rest. Leave dead trees, because the holes that woodpeckers peck in them and the sap that results attracts insects, which are then easy pickings for hummingbirds. Hummingbirds need spider silk because they make their webs with spider silk as a major construction ingredient. And that enables those nests to stretch, and the nest will be double its original size as those eggs hatch and the chicks grow because the nest construction includes flexible spider silk. If you find a chick of any species, hummingbird or otherwise, and you know where the nest is, go ahead and put it back in the nest, because it's not true that the mother will reject the chick if it has human scent on its body. Hummingbird feeders. If you want to have a hummingbird feeder, I recommend this model, which is easy to clean. You just separate it into the two halves and clean each half and then reassemble. No food coloring, please, just water and sugar, and no substitutes for the sugar either. It can't be molasses, or it has to be straight sugar in a 4-to-1 ratio of water to sugar. You heat it to dissolve, refrigerate, use within 1 week, replace the food in the feeder every few days, and clean it every 3 days with hot tap water by scrubbing the sides. Do not use soap, because soap residue is harmful for the birds. Black mold can appear. If so, you'll have to soak your feeder in a bleach solution, 1:64 ratio, for 1 hour. Nectar can spoil and needs to be replaced if it does, and that can happen in just 1 day on a hot summer day. So I hope I've impressed on you what a responsibility it is to have a feeder if you decide to go that way. I would rather just give hummingbirds a lot of floral resources. The nectar in flowers is just the right balance of different kinds of sugar. It also provides the trace amounts of minerals, proteins, and amino acids that are essential for the hummingbird's health. A trumpet creeper is a robust vine. You don't want it near your foundation. It might be problematic, but elsewhere on your property, it will definitely draw in the hummingbirds. And so will trumpet honeysuckle. Cardinal flower, a fantastic, just the stunningly beautiful plant that can do well in moist situations, but can also handle normal soil. And if you keep the soil somewhat bare beneath that plant, you'll enable it to reseed. Wild columbine, this beautiful flower, is a native variety, a native species that is available and flowering in the spring when the hummingbirds arrive from their migration from South America. Butterfly weed is another one that they'll visit. Also, this incredibly valuable pollinator plant called Anis hyssop, which is in the mint family. Obedient plant, another mint. Blazing star, swamp milkweed, foxglove beard tongue, a spring blooming perennial, purple coneflower, and any phlox species. So on to bats, which are also beneficials because they're predators. They eat nothing but insects. The most common bats in New England are the little brown bat and big brown bat. Little brown bat we've lost 90% of that species due to white nose syndrome, which is a fungal disease. So offering a bat house, either constructed or purchased, might help them out, because that will start them out with a nice clean place to nest and with uninfected by that white nose syndrome. I'm offering this mass.gov link, which is a great resource to learn about bats. You're unlikely to be able to attract bats unless there's a body of water nearby where they can drink. You're not allowed to evict bats in the middle of the summer because they're raising their pups then. Please leave dead trees standing for bats and other wildlife. Don't use pesticides. Keep your cats indoors. If a cat finds the roost of a bat, it could decimate that roost. Minimize artificial lighting that distracts and disturbs bats in the at nighttime. And now on to those delightful butterflies and moths, the lepidopterans. Butterflies are much more well-known and popular because they're more colorful and they're active during the day. And moths are active primarily at night. Moths outnumber butterflies by about 20 to 1. Moths usually have feathery antennae contrasted with butterflies. They also spin cocoons while butterflies make chrysalises. Butterflies, in a study in Ohio, their population has been reduced by a third over just 2 decades. Habitat loss, pesticides, climate change are definitely a part of that problem. And a couple of years ago, a study was done in Germany that was alarming all over the world because it demonstrated that in the 27 years when they had been measuring the biomass of flying insects by trapping them in netting and weighing, the total number of insects had declined by 75% over a quarter of a century. And similar studies have been done to show that this is a problem. They call it the bugpocalypse all over the world. Insects are so important to the entire web of life. This is just not permissible. A world without insects is not a world that we want to or could live in. It'll be a flowerless world with silent forests, no birds left, a world of dung and old leaves and rotting carcasses, collapse or decay and erosion and loss that would spread through ecosystems, spiraling from predators to plants. So butterfly gardening, if you're wanting to attract butterflies, think about an area that has at least 6 hours of full sun. Near a water source would be helpful. Shelter from wind is also desirable. Host plants are absolutely essential. Nectar-producing plants throughout the growing season. And organic landscaping practices. Butterfly boxes are totally worthless. No one has ever found a butterfly in a butterfly box. So it's a mystery why they're even sold. Spiders, yes. Wasps, yes. But no butterflies. But consider about consider whether you might be able to give butterflies some mud. Males of many butterflies it's called puddling when they sip the mud to get the minerals from the mud. The reason that they do this is that they need those minerals for pheromones that they produce to attract the females. And when they mate with the females, they're able to donate those minerals to the females to make the eggs healthier. So we can give these male butterflies mud in a repurposed bird bath or in a saucer on the ground. Use gravel or sand. Add salt or compost to make sure those minerals are in it and keep it moist. Butterflies love fruit, and surprisingly, even if it's going bad, they don't seem to mind. And give them host plants. Here are some wonderful host plants for butterflies and moths: goldenrod, sunflower, asters, and black-eyed Susan. Notice all of these are in the aster family, Asteraceae. Host plants for butterflies and moths, trees and shrubs. The oak is number one at 473 different species of butterflies and moths. 411 species in the genus Prunus, which includes beech plum, cherry, and chokecherry. Willows are host to 399 species, birch to 393. There are many other trees and shrubs which are very valuable. Now, spice bush swallowtail females will only lay their eggs on a sassafras tree or a spice bush because those are the only leaves that are edible for those caterpillars. And don't you love those cute fake eyes on the sides of the of those caterpillars? They it's only meant to intimidate predators, but they cannot see out of those eyes. They're simply a decoration and a ruse. Black swallowtail caterpillars can eat anything in the parsley family: parsley, dill, fennel, Queen Anne's lace, carrots. The host plants for Baltimore checkerspot are turtlehead and plantain. The host plants for spring azure, New Jersey tea, viburnums, meadowsweet, and dogwood trees. And violet will be a food for the great spangled fritillary or other fritillary caterpillars. And we know that the monarchs are the most charismatic and certainly the most well-known butterfly of them all. And they absolutely need milkweed of some species. Common milkweed, you'll find it in fields. Very important for monarchs. However, I do not recommend that you plant common milkweed in your garden. It's way too aggressive. It'll send out runners, subterranean runners that will, it'll just take over the garden and it'll be very difficult to eradicate. So instead, I suggest a much more well-behaved swamp milkweed or butterfly weed in situations when where there is ample sunlight, and poke milkweed in the shade. Swamp milkweed, as the name implies, can handle moist soil, but normal soil is fine as well. Butterfly weed can handle dry soil, but again, can do well in normal soil. So swamp milkweed and butterfly weed are the two that are the most commonly used in butterfly gardens. Monarchs overwintering in Mexico have been measured, and over time, and marked decline. On the West Coast, the West Coast population has almost been eliminated. And it's the glyphosate applied to agricultural crops that kills all the weeds. Including the milkweeds, that is a major culprit, but also pesticide use, climate change, logging and development are having their impact as well. So you can proudly proclaim that you are helping monarchs by posting a sign in the Monarch Way Station. You can order it from monarchwatch.org, and they will give you information about how to do that. Here's an example of a Monarch Way Station garden provided by edibleterrace.com. You'll notice that there's only a dozen species here, and two of them are actually grasses. Also notice that there are clumps of one particular species. So rather than having them evenly dispersed throughout the garden, I think it looks better this way, but also it's easier for the butterflies to find flowers of the same species if they're all clustered together. So according to Sharon Stichter, who compiled this list about a decade ago for the North American Butterfly Association, here are the top 15 butterfly plants, but I think that she might have changed her mind since then about butterfly bush, including that, because it's it's certainly the case that butterflies will eagerly help themselves to the nectar of these flowers, there are some problems. The first is that it's a host plant for no butterfly or bee, or moth caterpillars. And the other issue, which is more important, is that it seems to be invasive. So watch out for butterfly bushes, but why not use instead New Jersey tea, a native shrub, or sweet pepper bush. Compass plant is a very tall perennial. It's also called cup plant because you can see that the leaves embrace the stem in such a way that a bowl is created that's filled with water that insects and birds can sample after a rain. Blazing star is also on her list, as is thistle, which is a fairly weedy species, but it's still quite popular with butterflies. Any of the asters are good. Purple coneflower again. Scabiosa, Joe pieweed, a tall perennial that can grow in moist areas, but it's also fine in normal soil. The same could be said of boneset and the milkweeds. Zinnia is one of the annuals that she recommends. Another one, Mexican sunflower, and also marigolds. Now think about when you plant perennials or other plants that you're offering to pollinators and butterflies and other pollinators, will deer eat them? So here are a couple of websites to investigate or just do a search about deer-resistant plants for pollinators. And you might also need to deal with rabbits or groundhogs. Here are some links to help you with those hungry vegetarians. Now, if you don't have too much land to work with, you might be able to put some potted plants here and there that will do the job. And the larger the pot, the better in terms of the amount of watering that you'll need to do to make sure those plants are adequately irrigated. And you might have a strip of land between your sidewalk and the road that could become a beautiful habitat for wildflowers. Susanna Lerman is a scientist based in Amherst, Massachusetts, who has demonstrated, she did a study in which some lawns were mowed every week and some lawns were mowed every other week. And that one simple change made a fantastic difference. Lawns mowed every other week gave these wonderful flowers a chance to establish and bloom. 111 different native bee species were found in those lawns that were mowed every other week, and not nearly as many flowers in the lawns mowed every week. So you can call it what you will, bee and butterfly lawn, lazy lawnmower lawn, freedom lawn, whatever you call it, it's a great resource, or it can be a great resource for pollinators, if of course you do not apply any broadleaf herbicide to the lawn. And consider whether a wildfire meadow might be a good approach for your landscape where there's currently lawn or other vegetation. You would need at least 400 square feet, which is not that much total, to make a meadow look good and for it to work functionally. I invite you to go to the unh.edu, New Hampshire University of New Hampshire Extension Service, and do a search for wildfire meadows to learn about how to do this. You'll need some patience and time and some investment. The first year, you have to totally eliminate all vegetation, including any seeds that are viable in the seed bank or in the soil. And then once that's, so you could set about and learn how to do that, either by smothering or other means. And that could be accomplished by the end of this year, if you began soon with your plan. And then in October or November, you could spread the seed, which needs to include grasses as well as wildflowers. I recommend that you do not use wildflower seed in a can or something like that. Just go to a reputable place that has a lot of experience with what will work long term where you live. So, but consider what a delight this can be, and also consider how much money you will save eventually, even after the initial outlay. It would be, a great return on your investment, and you can save money as well as feel good about what you're doing for wildlife. Bees are the best pollinators because they have fuzzy bodies. And the bee that we're most familiar with is the non-native honeybee. This bee was not here until British colonists brought it over a few centuries ago. Before it was brought here, we only had the native bees. And there are about 400 different species of native bees that were doing just fine before the honeybee came along. As a matter of fact, there might be some competition where the honeybee is the presence of the honeybee is problematic to the native bees. It might spread diseases to the native bees. It might actually compete with them in some cases for the pollen and nectar. Honeybees are important to us because they are used to pollinate so many crops, and we also get honey from them. If you tell me that you've been stung by a bee, I'll ask you, are you sure it's not a yellow jacket that stung you? Because wasps. A yellow jacket is a wasp. Yellow jackets have their nests in the ground, and it's easy to step on a nest, and yellow jacket will let you know immediately that you don't belong there. Bumblebees are the other, I suppose, group of bees that are most familiar to us because they are large. They're not dangerous, though. A bumblebee will virtually never sting you. In fact, you can pet a bumblebee. They're remarkable animals. These pollen baskets, which honeybees often also have, are pollen which they collect on their hind legs, and by adding nectar to those, they're called corbiculae, those pollen balls just get bigger and bigger. The female needs to begin her brood of eggs every year from scratch in the spring. So she has to forage adequate quantities of pollen and nectar from flowers to feed both herself and the colony that she's establishing until the worker bees help her out with those chores. Buzz pollination is something that bumblebees are able to do. These are tomato flowers, and notice that there's no pollen on the outside of these stamens. It's all inside the stamens. Bumblebee knows just what to do. It attaches itself to the stamens and then vibrates its thoracic muscles at a certain frequency that causes the pollen to be dislodged and land on its body. That's why people who raise tomatoes actively encourage and house those bumblebees in those in a bumblebee box. Raspberries, cranberries, blueberries, strawberries, and cucumbers are also pollinated by bumblebees. And here's a native wildflower turtlehead, which only bumblebees are strong enough to access. And flowers often have a kind of a branding in which they advertise to with their scent, with their color. They advertise pollinators, their ability to, availability to pollinators. And if the bumblebee is able to get a lot of high quality nectar in one flower, it'll be motivated to then seek out another flower just like that. This is also the case with bottle gentian, which is a flower that never opens more than you see it, but a butterfly is strong enough to work its way into that flower and help itself to the nectar. Rusty patched bumblebees used to be common here in Massachusetts. They are extinct, however. They haven't been seen in New England for a long time. American bumblebees are very rare and used to be quite common. The two that we're most likely to find in New England are common eastern bumblebee and two spotted bumblebee. And you can see in the graph that they're actually more common than they used to be. However, most of the others have declined dramatically or are not seen at all in New England anymore due to climate change and loss of habitat, but also pests, pathogens, pesticides, poor nutrition due to the lack of numbers and quantity of flowers and variety of flowers. Pollution can be an issue because it can actually impede their ability to smell the flowers. Plants that are non-natives and invasives also are displacing the native plants that they need. If you leave abandoned mouse and birds' nests, that can be a habitat for that female bumblebee to set up a colony. And leave it be landscaping in general is wildlife friendly. Bumblebee nesting boxes can be made or purchased. You'd have to provide the bedding because bumblebees can't do that. They would just find it available in nature. Bumblebee mimics the flies that look like bumblebees so that they won't be, that gives them some protection from predators. Sweat bees are a native bee that is ground dwelling. They're small, they're beautiful, they're harmless, and they're important pollinators. There are many, many species. They're attracted to our perspiration. That's why they're called sweat bees. And this remarkable plasterer bee that the female can actually line that tunnel with something that resembles plastic and serves that function to keep the keep that chamber watertight and a safe place for the egg to grow. It'll drop down into that, it's called bee bread, the combination of pollen and nectar that's offered for the egg. And that notice that the plastic bag is sealed and the mature bee will eat its way out of that plastic bag in the spring. So this is another important ground dwelling insect. Habitat for ground nesting bees can be offered just simply by providing bare spaces that are several yards across with loose well-drained soil. Flat areas or earthen banks can work well. Sunny and south-facing can be good. South soil-filled planters are even an option. And stay off these areas so they don't disturb the nesting bees. Blue orchard mason bee is a small bee that's very important for orchardists because they're much more efficient predators than honeybee, much more efficient pollinators than honeybees are. After a mason bee visits a flower, it's much more likely to go to a different tree and deposit that pollen and pick up pollen from that next flower. While the honeybees, by contrast, are much more likely to just stay on a given tree and go from one flower to the other on that same tree, which does the plant no good in terms of pollination. Giving mason bees mud can be helpful because that's how they partition their chambers. They're a cavity nesting bee. And remarkably, this leafcutter bee is able to cut very neat circles out of leaf blades, roll them up, and stuff them into the cavity where she'll lay her eggs. Leafcutter bees visit blueberry, onion, carrot, and alfalfa flowers and pollinate them. And here are some of the leaves that they use for lining their cavities. And I have some tick trefoil in my pollinator garden, and I found leaves that had those telltale circles cut out. And I had never seen this before. And I was so excited to know that my pollinator garden was actually helping them out. you'll see a picture, that photo in the lower right of rose leaves. Owners of rose shrubs might not appreciate those neat circles being cut out of their leaves, but we can assure them that their rose plants are not being harmed, that the leaves will have plenty of surface area remaining to keep that plant nice and healthy. And so it's important to be tolerant of insect damage in cases like this. So someone drilled a hole in a wood block, and three different species of bees use those holes for nesting. The leafcutter bee on top, there are at least a half dozen distinct chambers that have been enclosed by those leaf blades. Rosin bee in the middle, rosin was used to partition the chambers. And there are about four or five cocoons visible in the mason bee chamber at the bottom, partitioned by mud. So you can offer a bee hotel with different sized openings of those stalks that are a Japanese knotweed stalk, by the way, is our Japanese knotweed stalks from the previous year that are dead, can be cut in sections and offered in for this purpose, and they work well. And there's some other species here on this slide. Notice that someone in that photo at the bottom of the slide is rolling a piece of paper around a dowel, or he could use a pencil for that purpose. And the goal is to insert that piece of paper into each of the into each of the stalks, and then collect the cocoons. So at the end of the season, the diseased cocoons will be eliminated. You'll see them on the upper right of this slide, and the healthy cocoons will be saved and put in the refrigerator, and will be set out in a release box with a hole in it in the spring, when all danger of cold weather has passed. And so we can help bees in that way if we're providing good habitat for those cavity nesting bees. And I'd like to suggest the following plants that are native bee magnets for your garden and landscape that attract at least seven native bee genera. Wild bergamot takes first place, Monarda fistulosa. 15 different native bee genera will feed on that plant. And wild bergamot is a mint. It's related to bee balm, which is Monarda didymum, that red flowering plant that's quite well known. Black-eyed Susan is in second place, Rudbeckia hirta, with 14, at 13, boneset. And tied for third place, swamp milkweed and butterfly weed, the two milkweeds that we've mentioned before. Tick seed, oxeye sunflower, mountain mint, and blue vervain. A word about mountain mint, it's an incredibly valuable pollinator plant for a variety, not just native bees, but other insects as well. You see the great black wasp on the right, totally harmless wasp, a beautiful insect. Tachinid flies are beneficial, and the bumblebee is also pictured here. It's a lesson in entomology to watch your patch of mountain mint and all the different insects it attracts over a period of months. So there will be thousands of insect visits in the growing season. Another wonderful thing about mountain mint is you can take some of those leaves, crush them, put them on your, rub them on your skin, and they're an effective mosquito repellent for at least a half hour. On with the list. Foxglove beard tongue, and in the lower right corner, golden Alexanders are both spring blooming perennials. And it's good to have those spring blooming flowers when the bees are really hungry and need those resources. And cup plant or compass plant and New England aster, two more Asteraceae, aster family members. Two more aster family, a big leaf aster and yellow coneflower, plus the wild geranium, a spring blooming perennial. Anise hyssop, purple coneflower, Jacob's ladder, Ohio spiderwort, ironweed, a very tall plant, and culver's root, which can grow in the shade. And a word about purple coneflower. The cultivars are offered. There are about 100 different varieties that have been bred by, and are sold by nurseries. Problem with that is that either bees can't see them very well, bees or butterflies, which is the case with green jewel, or with Magnus. There's just no stamens or there's no pollen or nectar left in those flowers. And the same is true of double delight, even though they seem to be more similar to purple coneflower. The the nectar and pollen resources have just been eliminated. And there are others, there are other flowers that have this problems with their availability of floral resources. So try to go with the straight species, which is what it's called, the original unmodified native plant, which needs our help, because if we plant the varieties, they aren't going to be able to establish themselves in nature. But the ones that have been around for a while, such as purple cumflower, it still has a place in the wild. And on with the list, the harebell, wild lupin, and bloodroot. Some of the plants that don't do pollinators any good are pansy, daylily, a very low value, hybrid tea rose. There's no floral resources there, no nectar, no pollen. Same is true for double marigold, petunia and New Guinea impatiens, peony, very low value or none at all. And then forsythia, again, very low value plants. Invertebrate predators and parasites. This is the other two P's followed by the pollinators. So pollinators, predators, and parasites are the beneficials. Spiders eat everything possible, so they're generalists. So do praying mantises. So they get good press as being important beneficials, but really it's insects such as lacewings, which are much more important because they eat primarily the pest insects. And that's what you're looking for is predators of those pests. So it's the larvae of the lacewings that are going after mealybugs, spider mites, thrips, aphids, and caterpillars. And the adult, as you see, is pollinating a flower. So you can attract the adults with your pollinator gardens. And you can also give lacewings a hotel by cutting off the bottom of a plastic bottle and rolling up a piece of cardboard, stuffing it in there and hanging it from a tree. Ladybugs, it's the larvae that are the voracious predators. You can see there are a lot of different species of ladybug beetles out there, and they too are pollinators. A ladybug hotel is simply a mesh bag with pine cones in it. Fireflies are beneficial because they prey on insect larvae, snails, and slugs, offer them low-hanging trees, forest litter, long grasses, ponds, and streams. No fertilizers or pesticides. Please turn off your outdoor lights because they're a distraction to them. Assassin bugs are also valuable predators, as are hoverfly or the serpent fly, which preys on aphids, and the adult does pollinate as well. Trichogramma wasps are very effective parasites. They're tiny wasps that lay their eggs in much larger eggs of pest species. And bracketed wasps, incredibly diverse group of wasps that preys on many different pests. So these are real heroes in the category of beneficials. So we can attract these parasites and predators with the following plants in the dill family or fennel family, Queen Anne's lace and carrots also. And then plants in the aster family, goldenrod, tansy, marigold, dandelion, boneset, yarrow, coreopsis, and aster are all in that family. And in the mint family, horse mint, fantastic plant for drawing in the wasps that are beneficial. Bugleweed, this is a valuable lawn flower that you can give that a chance to bloom if you're mowing only every other week. The wild bergamot, which I already mentioned is coming in first place for native bees, is also featured here. Anise hyssop, you've also been seeing recommended. So integrated pest management, or IPM, is the organic approach to managing garden pests. You can also think of it as intelligent pest management, because why would you want to apply toxins to an area and jeopardize the health of our native species? So a barrier such as floating row cover is one very effective means of controlling these pests. Companion plants is another approach where they might be repelled by plants that they don't like. Hand picking can be feasible, and organic pesticides are important, in addition to inviting the pollinators and predators with your pollinator gardens. Another consideration is that if your garden plants, whether you're talking about your vegetable garden or your annuals or what have you, if they are brimming with vitality, they are much more resistant to pests and diseases. And that stands to reason. The same is true for humans. If we're in good health, we're less likely to come down with diseases that are trying to take us down. So And so one way to make your plants really healthy is to garden organically, and in particular by using a foliar spray, because leaves actually can drink through these microscopic stomata, which are like lips that open and close. So if you give them foliar spray, give them different substances such as products from the sea, like kelp spray or that sort of thing, or even well, there's a variety of foliar sprays. You can do your homework about that, but that's one way to organic method of making your plants very vibrant with health. Now, we don't ordinarily think of trees and shrubs as being pollinator habitat, but because they have so many flowers, they're incredibly valuable to pollinators, and they have more flowers every year as they grow. And the willow is perhaps the number one pollinator plant that I would like to urge you to plant if at all possible, because it's providing a lot of pollen and nectar for so many different kinds of pollinators in the early spring when they need those resources, and on into the spring, in later spring. So a willow is a fantastic pollinator plant. Witch hazel can be offering either early spring or late fall floral resources. Redbud, beautiful ornamental, which is also beneficial for insects. Fruit trees offer a lot of flowers. American plum is an example of a native fruit tree. Beech plum as well, from the Cape. These flowers are just swarming. The insects are swarming over these flowers when they're in bloom. Black cherry and choke cherry, Virginia rose and Carolina rose, the Juneberry flowers, even maples and oaks which don't have noticeable petals, colorful petals, they still have the pollen and nectar that bees can take advantage of. Basswood flowers are very inviting to bees. Basswood tree, or the linden tree as it's also called. Blueberry flowers, red osier dogwood flowers, common ninebark. But here's another example of where the cultivar, which has the one with red ones with red leaves, and there are many cultivars of ninebark, are just not edible to certain species, such as this beautiful ninebark leaf beetle. So the straight species, unaltered native plant is always preferable. Winterberry holly has those flowers for pollinators as well. Staghorn sumac can be a pretty aggressive spreader, so keep that in mind on your property. It can almost be like an invasive, but it's very beneficial. So if you can manage it simply by mowing around it, that'll keep the area where it's established in check. Viburnums and native hydrangeas are the ones that are the valuable for pollinators. And mountain laurel, which can grow in the shade and attracts a lot of wonderful butterflies, and a beautiful plant. Spring ephemerals are also valuable because you can plant them in areas that are shaded by trees after those trees come out, after they leaf out, and there's still sun there below them. Snowdrops, crocuses, grape hyacinth, Siberian squill, wild bleeding heart, even in the fall, it could even flower virtually all year. Wild bleeding heart, bloodroot, and we've also seen. And then some annuals, I mentioned sunflower, Mexican sunflower, and zinnia before for butterflies. Also spider flower, ageratum, sweet alyssum, borage, pineapple sage, cosmos are among the annuals that will attract pollinators. Culinary herbs, if you allow them to flower, basil, chives, rosemary, oregano, lavender, and catmint are all valuable as well. And by visiting that same website that I recommended for wildflower meadows, extension.unh.edu, you will see Kathy Neal's list of pollinator plants that starting out in June, starting out in early spring in May with the golden alexanders, and going all the way down the list to into the fall with the New England asters. So this is a flowering calendar which shows how long the flower blooms and what color it is. So it's a valuable list. It's a good goal to have at least three different species in the spring that are blooming, three species in the summer, and three in the late summer and fall. And if you have at least three individuals, genetically distinct individuals of each species, that would give you a total of at least 27 plants And that would get you started for a pollinator garden. But that would be the bare minimum that would be recommended. But if you could just set out to collect as many of these as you can, that would be great. Sometimes when you buy seeds, they're dormant. And so in order to break dormancy, you need to treat them with a prolonged period of moisture and cool temperatures between 34 and 41 degrees Fahrenheit. So your refrigerator is ideal for this, but also if you put seeds out in the fall and just put them in pots or in trays and let the, they'll experience winter that way and they will have enough of that cool and wet conditions so that they'll just break dormancy naturally. Either way you do it, if you choose to put them in the refrigerator, use vermiculite as the substance that will help it to maintain moisture. Sand could also work for large seeds or moist paper towel for small seeds. And there's some good, the Wild Seed Project, that second URL at the bottom here, is an excellent resource to learn about starting seeds. Don't hesitate to plant them densely. They seem to like company, like teenagers. But eventually they'll get big enough so you'll want to put them in, you'll want to create these called plugs, in trays or some other means of giving them enough space. You can also purchase plugs for only a dollar or two per plug. You're assured that they will each be a genetically distinct individual, which is not necessarily the case when you're buying a larger plant. They could all be clones of each other. Also, you'll be getting a lot of them for not very much money. So you could establish a pollinator garden that had those 27 individuals that I suggested for starters for $50 or less. Or you grow them from seed from seed yourself if you choose. Vegetative propagation does have its place. This was a clump of four stems of the swamp milkweed that I decided to separate with the use of clippers, and you can see that each stalk now has its own root supply, which will be adequate to be planted out, and so that I could spread that plant in different locations where I wanted it. And since I already had other genetically distinct individuals out there, I knew that there would still be a lot of variety by doing that. So layering is another approach. If you bury a stem and induce it to form roots that way, and then cut it off from the parent plant, separate it and plant it out. You can also do cuttings. Remove the lower stems after you cut a stem, remove the lower leaves so that you're not burying leaves in the pot. And a surprising number of plants can be propagated this way. Because I'm in Massachusetts, I've created this list of native plant nurseries in Massachusetts. You can do your homework and find nurseries in Connecticut. And New England native plant seeds are also offered here. I recommend that you, if you're thinking about a wildflower meadow, for example, I highly recommend that you use a trusted company like one of these here, which they'll be able to give you not only the right balance of plants and grasses that will do well for you, they can also give you advice. So I encourage you to think about nurseries and these seed companies as being sources of information as well as sources of plants. And for example, if you have a situation that's either moist or dry or perhaps acidic or basic conditions, soil conditions, or shade or sun, all these different variables that you might be concerned about. Well, what will grow well here? And you'll find that the staff in these companies have a lot of experience with plants and will be able to give you good advice. You can also get good advice. Again, this is a Massachusetts resource. Perhaps there's something like this in Connecticut. This is called the Tower Hill Hortline, and you can send them a plant photo if you don't know what a plant is, and they'll help you ID that plant. And if the plant doesn't look very well and you're trying to figure out how to diagnose and treat that plant, perhaps they can help you with that as well. You can join a garden club and get a lot of information that way and a lot of fellowship, or just in your neighborhood, there might be gardeners. The more you learn, the more you want to share with other people, and other people are eager to learn and share with what they have, and also to share the plants themselves. Collaborating on projects is a great way to, just inviting people or offering to help is a great way to bring people together and accomplish big things. Invite children to be stewards of nature. What a wonderful experience it is for children to have the pride of accomplishment, that they see that they're helping wildlife. Perhaps they're growing food, and that'll give them good experience of eating healthy food and wanting to eat that way in the future. And we'll be also creating the next generation of environmentalists and activists who care deeply about the planet. All decisions must maximize the welfare of the unborn unto the seventh generation. This is the great binding law of the Iroquois Confederation. It is our responsibility, clearly, to make all our decisions with these, with our ancestors, or rather our descendants in mind, and not only the human population, but all the plants and animals that cannot speak for themselves. There is no limit to what we can do together. So start where you are, and thank you for doing your part. Here is my email address, info@johnroot.net. Please don't hesitate to send me a request for the resources that I offered earlier in the presentation, or any other questions you might have. I'm wondering if there are any comments or questions.
There are some questions here, John. Is there a role for town government to encourage or require golf courses or condo associations to use environmentally friendly fertilizers, pesticides, and weed killers?
Goodness, I hope that there is a role. In my hometown of Amherst, Massachusetts, I've been working with an organization called Western Mass Pollinator Networks. So I was instrumental in encouraging them to pass a non-binding pollinator resolution. So I have to underline that those words, non-binding. In other words, they have committed on their honor to do what they can to minimize the use of pesticides and maximize pollinator-friendly practices in landscaping on town-owned property. So this is a resolution that's focused on municipally owned property because that's what they have control over. In general, no, they don't have control over private property, unfortunately. I would love to imagine a future in which it's simply not legal to do a lot of things that are now standard practice and are harming the environment. Unfortunately, I don't think we've really reached that point yet. So we have to take things one step at a time. But certainly, I'm sure there are groups. If you do if you search for Connecticut pollinator citizen campaigns, that sort of thing, I know that there's a lot happening in Connecticut. But I think it's much more about encouraging people to do the right thing than ordering them not to do the wrong thing.
Great. Okay, so this is a three-part question from Betsy. Are thistles beneficial for pollinators?
Yes.
What types of plants support praying mantis? Also, mullein, M-U-L-L-E-I-N.
Mullein, yes. Okay. Mullein is a plant. So I'm not sure what the question is about the mullein. Praying mantises, the more insects out there are, the more praying mantises you'll have. I commented that I didn't think that praying mantises were all that important as beneficial, since they are generalists. They eat any insect they can find. In fact, praying mantises have even been known to prey on hummingbirds, surprisingly. I think that it's more important to encourage the beneficial predators and parasites that I mentioned as being particularly effective in controlling pest populations. Establishing the same plants that we're inviting the bees and butterflies in, those same plants will also attract the predators and parasites that I mentioned.
Okay. Do you recommend bee houses? I think you already answered yes. that, John, but and if so, what works best?
There is a good website to learn more. It's a commercial website. It's called Crown Bees, C-R-O-W-N, Crown Bees. So they sell different things there. but they also have a lot of information. So that's why I'm recommending that particular resource, just to educating yourself about bee hotels. So I think that you should avoid purchasing tubes that are of uniform size and dimensions, because there's a wide variety of different types of native bees that need different size tubes. So that's why if you use natural stalks, there will naturally be a variety size openings of those stalks, some smaller, some larger. So that would be preferable. So often the natural approach is preferable to, you know, just having a standard size, for example. And also don't use bamboo because it's not porous enough, and don't use plastic straws because those are not porous enough. So, you know, Japanese knotweed is one plant that's very common, because unfortunately it's an invasive. So we might as well use it if we can find it. You can use those dead stalks in your motel. The bottom line, of course, is that they won't be used unless you have adequate floral resources. If you have the meadow or the pollinator garden with enough flowers to attract those mason bees or leafcutter bees that need the bee hotel. So that'll be a kind of a marker of your success. If you're providing for the bees, then you might be able to have a bee hotel.
Okay, what kind of bee bores a hole in wood?
Carpenter bee.
Okay, a lot of people said, thank you very much. This is an amazing program. Someone said they have 2 acres and they want to use for pollinators.
Great.
John says, what would you suggest as an alternative to weed killer? Also, a condo complex has cicada killers every year that terrify the residents until the exterminator comes. Is there another option?
Those are thorny questions. As far as alternative to weed killers, ask yourself, why do you have weeds in the first place? There's a book called Weedless Gardening by Lee Reich. So if you have, if you're growing vegetables, for example, well, weeds don't stand a chance if you have well-mulched garden beds. Right? And if an occasional weed might pop up, it's easy to pull that weed because the soil is so nice and moist below the mulch. So you shouldn't need any weed killers if you're approaching things, if you appreciate the value of mulch by preventing them in the first place.
They meant weed killer for lawns.
Yes. The bottom line with lawns, for example, if you're trying to deal with plantain, plantain is the weed that often, it's called white man's footprint because Native Americans realized that it was growing wherever we had a pass, and it's a non-native plant. So it's usually, the bottom line is the health of the lawn that's the problem. So if you focus on getting your lawn more healthy with organic methods, adequate aeration could be an issue. So to deal with any compaction problems, you might want to enlist the help of a qualified professional to help you figure out what to do. But it's not treating the symptoms is not a cure. If you address the cause of why the weeds are getting the upper hand in the first place, and I would suggest also that because Kentucky bluegrass is, as I mentioned, a species that's on life support rather than supporting life. If you seed with turf type tall fescue and replace that Kentucky bluegrass, it's going to be more competitive, I would think, and keeping up those weeds.
Are organic oils to repel ticks applied by organics company, but they're costly? Are they worthwhile?
To deal with ticks?
Organic oils to repel ticks, yes.
Organic oil to repel ticks. I had a slide which included 4 different ingredients that are used in repellents. I don't know if they're all as costly, one compared to the other. I believe they're fairly effective. I think the permethrin spray is the most effective, which I also mentioned. If you spray your clothes with permethrin, that is very effective, and your gear. That kills the ticks outright. they don't have the chance. So that's the most effective means of keeping them at bay.
Okay, and Betsy, certainly let us know if that answers your question. There's another question. What is a good environment for fireflies?
I think low-hanging leaves and just in general, I think a water feature is welcoming to fireflies. Nothing specific comes to mind in terms of plant species, but you might do some research about that.
Okay. For a bee hotel with knotwood, how long should each piece?
That plant is knotweed, Japanese knotweed.
Oh, sorry, not for a bee hotel with knotweed, how long should each piece of knotweed be cut?
Oh, about, I think, 6 inches. I believe also it's a range of 3 to 6 inches. The narrower tubes can be shorter, while the wider tubes should be longer, the full 6 inches long.
Okay. How to naturally get rid of red lily bottle besides hand picking?
Red lily bottle? I'm not familiar.
I bond. Can you elaborate on that? Or L bond? Beetle. How to naturally get rid of red lily beetle besides hand picking?
I don't know anything about red lily beetles.
Oh, okay. Did you want to ask it a different way or?
Well, I'm just not familiar with them, so I wouldn't.
Yeah, okay. All right. Well, that was the last question in the chat box. If you want to, certainly raise your hand if you have a question or put it in the chat box for John.
And going back to that earlier question about mullein, the person who wrote that in might mean, is mullein a pollinator? Is that a good pollinator?
I believe so. In fact, moths might pollinate it.
Thanks.
It's a biennial, yeah. It grows the rosette of leaves at the base and then sends up that stalk, that tall stalk in the second year. Mullein tea is a good tea to use for a sore throat if you collect the leaves.
Thank you.
Will you be distributing the recording to all on the call? Yes, I did start it a little bit late. I apologize. I was trying to respond to emails from people trying to get in, but I did record it and I will send it out in the morning after I kind of edit it and put a title to it and that sort of thing. But yes, I will send it out in the morning.
There are a couple more questions, I think.
Oh, did I miss them? Some people have their hand raised too.
Right. So how do I get rid of sticky spurweed?
I'm not familiar with that.
Oh, sorry, go ahead. Go ahead, John.
I'm not familiar with that. Okay. What was the name of that plant again?
Sticky spurweed.
I've never heard of it.
Okay.
So Mary Beth has a question. I'm going to allow her to talk.
Hi, John. I was wondering if you could possibly share the graphics of all the butterfly enticing plants that you put up. I wasn't quick enough to write them all down, and I'm kind of starting from scratch in my garden. So I'd really like to have a listing of those plants.
Okay, here we go.
I mean, is there a way to possibly?
In other words, the top 15?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I can show them to you again, or if you send me an email, info@johnroot.net, I can just list them for you.
I will do that.
Okay. Yeah,
for the sake of time, I will just send you an email. Thank you.
Sure.
And another question from Eileen. Are elderberries edible for humans or
yes.
Do they need to be cooked first?
I recommend that you cook them first. They taste a lot better that way for sure. But they're absolutely delicious cooked. Elderberry pancakes, wonderful. Elderberries in your hot cereal, elderberry muffins, you name it.
I think that's all we have. Oh, do we have another hand raised?
I'm not sure if this is the same. Is this the same person right here? Is this Mary Beth? Is that who was before?
I'm not quite sure.
I've already asked my question. Thank you very much.
Okay. I thought there was another raised hand. Okay, I think that's all the questions that we have. A lot of thank yous, very informative. Certainly check out John at info@johnroot.net. If you do have more questions, I'm sure he'll be able to answer those for you. I will send out the presentation tomorrow morning after I edit it. Let's see, Tara, did you have any other questions, comments?
No, thank you so much.
I would just like to say that my goal is here, and I'm gratified to hear your expressions of appreciation for the program. And my goals were to inform and inspire and also enlist, so that I'm hoping that you appreciate the importance of this issue and look for opportunities just to, when talking with people you know, or perhaps on a local level, making good things happen, because together we can do a lot.
Well, thank you. Your presentation was chock full of information, so it was really great. So wonderful.
Great. Thank you so much, John. And thank you so much for everyone for joining us. I hope you have a great night.
Good night.
Happy gardening.
Bye.
Bye.